Okay. The central, my name is Victoria Steele, and I live in the Tucson area. I'm a former state legislator. The central focus of my campaign is economic hope and fairness. I grew up in coal mining country in Pennsylvania. I knew poverty, I knew child abuse, but I also knew that I was loved. My parents taught me the value of hard work. And I knew, with love and hard work, that I could achieve that American dream. My parents believed in it, I believed in it. And that's that dream that if you play by the rules and you work really hard, you should be able to get ahead in life. You should be able to have enough money to send your kids to college, to put a roof over your head, to pay the bills. If nothing else, the necessities. Maybe save for an occasional vacation. Save for retirement. That American dream is getting further and further out of reach for people. I have known some pretty tough times, and I've known a lot of people who have gone through some pretty tough times. And here's what their experiences and my own have really taught me. They say that money can't buy happiness. Well, that might be true. But I'm here to tell you, poverty can make you miserable. It truly can. And yes, families can be resilient. But we need to lift up working class families every chance, wherever we can, so that they have a fighting chance at that American dream. These are the values, these family values, are the values that are at the heart of my campaign priorities. So what are those priorities? Well, let me tell you what they are. My priorities are moving our economy ahead and creating good paying jobs, protecting Social Security and Medicare, and addressing climate change. So when it comes to turning our economy around and creating those good paying jobs, here's what we need to do. We need to invest in our infrastructure, our transportation infrastructure, our solar clean energy infrastructure, and our water infrastructure, particularly here in the desert. We need to incentivize small businesses who create great paying jobs for people so that they'll create more better paying jobs. We need to incentivize the small businesses because they are the job creators, not the biggest corporations. We need to increase the federal minimum wage because, by God, this is America. People should not be living in poverty and still holding down a full-time job. Minimum wage these days does not cut it. We also need to close the gender pay gap. Why? Why? This is 2016. And we are still women getting paid less than what a man makes for the same job? That's not even funny. Let's get on with it. Let's close the gender pay gap. The majority of the population are women, and a lot of them are heads of household. So we really need to pay attention to that, because when women do well, we all do well. We also need to have affordable child care. We need to have affordable child care because the cost of paying for child care for children these days, for young families, is crippling. And we need to give them the ability to get out and get a job so that they can take care of their families. This is just common sense stuff. We also need to invest in public education. We need to invest in public education, pre-K through postgraduate school, so that we have a highly skilled workforce, a highly educated, trained, prepared, ready workforce to take all of those new jobs that we're going to create. We can do this. Arizona can be a global leader just in solar. And I know I've gone off track already, but this is important to me. This is such a big, we can be a world leader in solar. We truly can. We can be a world leader in biotechnology, biomedicine. We have so much going for us here in Arizona that we're not taking advantage of. Instead, we keep giving big corporations like prisons the tax breaks. So we really need to focus on public education. We need to focus on building our infrastructure and growing that, and giving families a break. Addressing climate change. This is one of the most critical issues facing our planet today. We have to address, we need leaders who have the courage to address climate change now, before it's too late, to ensure that our children and our grandkids will have clean air to breathe and clean water to drink. We owe it to our kids to be good stewards of our natural resources. Protecting and strengthening Social Security and Medicare. This is a no-brainer. This is a sacred contract between every American worker. Seniors have paid into this. You have paid into this program, Social Security and Medicare, all of your life. You've paid into this program, and you deserve the benefits that you were promised. I will vigorously oppose any cuts to Social Security, to Medicare, and to disability benefits. So what are we talking here? Good paying jobs, retirement security, and clean air and water. Not exactly a controversial agenda, is it? No, it's not. Yet Congress can't seem to even make the smallest dent in any of these issues. I am frustrated. People are frustrated. We should be frustrated. We should expect more. My opponent, my Republican opponent, wants to trick you into believing that she's a moderate. But if you look at what she's really doing, not what she says, but what she does, if you look at her votes, she is in lockstep with the most extreme wing of her party. Just look at how she's voted. She's voted 7 times to defund Planned Parenthood. She has voted 7 times to dismantle or repeal the Affordable Care Act. She has voted 2 times to block the Paycheck Fairness Act. What does she have against women? Come on! She has a miserable record on the environment. There were 35 environmental votes in Congress last year. 34 times she voted against things like solar energy, clean air, clean water. Okay, what does she have against clean air and clean water? I don't get it. That doesn't make any sense. And just last week, the Alliance for Retired Americans came out with their ranking of the votes. She has a miserable 30% ranking on issues impacting senior citizens. Her voting record is atrocious. You are not her top priority. Her top priority is getting what? Re-elected. That is her top priority. She is the second highest fundraiser in Congress, and she's taking money from Wall Street bankers, from Washington insiders, from a lot of people who do not live here, a lot of people who can't even vote for her. I'm going to tell you, my campaign is funded by Southern Arizona's people who live here, people who I know, who I meet face to face, who know me, and people who can vote for me. The only way her supporters, that are giving her millions of dollars, by the way, can vote for her is if they change their voting address from New York City to Tucson or Cochise County. That's the only way. The people that are funding her campaign seem to believe that they are outsiders, don't even live in Arizona, and they can buy this seat. Well, I've got news for them. Our democracy is not for sale. We must change the face of Congress. And I tell you, if there were more pro-choice Democratic women in Congress today, we would not be voting 7 times to repeal or to defund Planned Parenthood. No, we would be debating jobs and the economy. That's what we should be working on. This presidential year, presidential election year, is our best chance to take this seat back. These are exciting times. I've never seen this like this. We live in exciting times. It's scary. What could happen? We're this close to a Donald Trump presidency? Oh my God. But we have to pay attention to the down ballot races. We have to pay attention to this congressional race. Let me tell you why I think 2016's election season is so positive and why I am so optimistic about this race. In an election year where a president is being elected, Democrats come out to the polls in much greater numbers. So we know that. So we know we're going to see more Democrats. In fact, the last time that Martha McSally ran for office, or the first time she ran for office, she lost by like 2,500 votes. And that's because it was a presidential election year. Last time, midterm, guess what? We lost this seat by 167 votes. This is one of the most competitive races in the entire country, one of the top 10. And we know that because we lost this by only 167 votes. Don't let anybody tell you their vote doesn't count. We have proof. This was the tightest race in the entire country last time. Now, not only are we electing a president, we are electing a new president, which adds a whole nother level of excitement and hopefully engagement. If you know of a Democrat or an independent that's planning to not vote, I don't know. You know, I don't want to say anything violent, but oh my God. Why? Why? This is your power. You've got to vote. Even if you vote Republican, by God, vote. This is your power. You should have a say in what's happening. Now, what is happening on the GOP presidential race? As we watch that party, the entire party, implode. Wow, that's an embarrassment. That is an embarrassment. I'm proud to be a Democrat. I just got to tell you, I'm so proud to be a Democrat. Oh my God. Now, CD2, as I said, is one of the top, most competitive districts. Among the polling that has been done, there have been a couple of polls. Consistently, I am the top-rated Democrat to win, and I am only single digits behind Martha McSally. She is vulnerable. She is under that 50% favorability. For an incumbent Republican, she should be way above that. And I'm within single digits to catching up to her, and I haven't spent a dime on advertising. So that looks pretty good. Here's another thing that looks pretty good. A third of the voters in CD2, one out of every three, comes from my old legislative district, LD9, where I have been the top vote getter, the lowest money raiser, but the top vote getter in both very, very competitive races. I won them both. I am working hard to win this one too. Women are the make or break factor in these tight races across the country. We know that women's issues are particularly, and what issue isn't a woman's issue? And women's issues are everybody's issues. So women will be the make or break factor in these tight races. And so here's another interesting demographic that you should know about. In the Democratic primary in CD2, 60% of the electorate is made up of women. 60% of the Democratic primary electorate is made up of women. We can win this. I really believe it's going to take a woman to get this seat back. I really believe it's going to take a woman to go up against Martha McSally. I'm the woman for that job.
Yes.
Thank you. I also believe that Martha McSally is vulnerable. And if we don't take this seat back now, she's going to be entrenched. This has become urgent. This is serious business. We need to get this seat back. You saw the votes. There are a lot of other votes. And remember, one of her top political advisors is a guy named Jeff Rowe. He works with a company called Axiom. He is Ted Cruz's campaign manager. So don't buy into this, oh, she's so moderate. No, she's not. She'll tell you that she is. Look at her votes. Not a moderate. I still believe in the American dream, that if you work hard and you play by the rules, you should have a chance to live up to your potential in life. I still believe from the core of my being that everybody deserves a fighting chance. As your congresswoman, I will fight for you. I will fight for you. You will be my top priority. Thank you. Yes, sir.
I just have a question.
What's your name?
I totally agree with you that we need to get out and vote. But as we just saw in our presidential elections this week, so many people tried to vote and couldn't because of reduction in polling stations. Some kind of snafu where registered Democrats could not vote, were not allowed to vote because their registration somehow changed. As Congresswoman, what is your plan for creating a system that really represents us, that represents our vote, and that ensures that our vote is counted?
Could I have your name and...
My name is Matt Levy. I'm from Disney.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question, Matt. There is a huge effort to suppress the vote nationwide, but especially here in Arizona. I join with those calling for an investigation of what's happened in Arizona's presidential preference primary, because there were different problems in each area. But I think there is an obvious effort to suppress the vote. I mean, my work in the legislature tells me that quite clearly. Making felons out of people that want to pick up a mail-in ballot and take it in for your neighbor, for the lady that can't drive, pick that up and take it in to the polling place, making that person, that volunteer, all of a sudden a felon, that's so wrong. People died for the right to vote. Women have not had the right to vote that long. Native Americans, I'm Native. We have not had the right to vote for that long. These are precious, precious rights. We should be making it easier for people to vote, not harder. This is America. Everybody who wants to vote, who is a citizen, should be able to vote, right? Doesn't that make sense? So that is one of my, and you know what? There's something else that goes along with that. Citizens United. That has to be overturned. That really has to be overturned. There is too much emphasis on money in this race, in all of the races, and it's getting worse. So when you see people who are discouraged from running for office because they're not wealthy, that's a problem. When you see that people can't afford to run for office, that's a problem. I would rather have my leaders be people who know where I come from, who have lived a similar life, who are not so disconnected from the realities of balancing a budget and raising a family that they are completely greedy. We cannot have the Koch brothers and Washington insiders running the whole thing because they have the money. I have been disgusted. People have told me, Victoria, you're not raising enough money. How are you going to compete against Martha McSally? I don't need Martha McSally's millions of dollars. Neither my Democratic opponent nor I are going to be able to even come close to matching her dollar for dollar. And we don't have to. What we have to do is have enough money to run a competitive campaign that gets our word out. I am running a grassroots campaign. I am meeting everybody that I can. You will see me down here more. You will see me everywhere. I am accessible. You can reach me on Facebook. You can reach me on Twitter. You can text me. Pat knows. You can text me. I make myself available. That's one thing Gabby Giffords did. She made herself accessible. And I know that that also was a risk for her. She made herself accessible, and she was able to be vulnerable. But that also was her downfall. I know that that's a possibility, but I also know that we need people courageous enough to stand up and say, no, that's not how democracy works. You don't hide, you don't intimidate us. And it's not only about the money. She with the most money does not win. That's not how the game is played. Thank you. Pat.
Would you and your CD2 opponent be having forums or debates?
My Republican opponent?
No, your Democrat.
My Democratic opponent? I hope so. But at this point, we're in the process of trying. I just accepted an invitation to something yesterday. I don't even remember what it was, but I just accepted an invitation to speak at, you know, and it's not really a debate, I don't think. Mm-hmm. If it is, I'm okay with that. I really encourage the open expression of ideas and having people be able to see us side by side to understand what the differences are, because there are clear differences between me and both of my opponents, both my primary opponent and my opponent in the general. So there are differences. And I encourage you, once we have these forums, to come out. Come out and be involved in them. Pay attention. Ask questions. Yes. Anything? Anything else?
I was just going to ask, yes. I'm from Sierra Vista.
Great.
And it's a huge retirement military town.
Yes.
What, and probably up at Davis-Monthan you have the same.
Absolutely.
And how do you get across or put yourself out to those type of people who are entrenched, no matter who is running, they vote that one ticket? Mm-hmm. And that's, I've been there since 1981, and it's so frustrating.
It is frustrating, and I wish that I had the answer to that one. If I did, I'd be doing it. Whatever it took, I would be doing it. But yes, that to me is it that one-on-one, face to face, getting to know people, building the relationship. Somebody told me this a long time ago, and when he told me, he goes, "This is old politics, so it's probably not," but I think it's still true today. Is you've got to reach out and you've got to touch everybody whose vote you want 5 times. So I need to reach out and I need to touch you by Facebook, by knocking on your door, by speaking with you at a meeting, by shaking your hand, by sending you a piece of mail, maybe a television and radio advertisement. At this point, I can't afford that. But here I want to say one more thing about competing with Martha McSally and the millions. Think about, what is that money? What are those millions of dollars used for in a race? Television. I worked in television and radio for a long, long time. It's not nearly as powerful a media as it used to be. And particularly when you can record something and just go by the commercials, or you can mute the button, or you're not watching so much television anymore. You're doing other things. So, and once I've won the primary, you know this is one of the most competitive districts in the country. Once I've won the primary, the national groups will come in. But right now, it is a primary. And they don't want to spend their money on one candidate and have the other candidate the winner. So they want to wait. But after that, they will come in just like they did and make up the gap, just like they did in Gabby's races and Ron's races. They made up that funding gap. That will happen again. This is too important for them to let it go. So we will have their support. This is an exciting, exciting time. Yes?
Just so you know, our local radio station here has the cheapest rates
Yay!
They cover all the way from here down to the border of Mexico and halfway to Tucson.
Wonderful.
And he will help you record it.
Yeah, well, it's a little odd, but you get up at 11 o'clock at night. Yeah, you have to record at night because he doesn't come out
of the day.
Go with Joaquin.
I'm okay. Sharon.
A quick question. Where do you live?
I live in Tucson, central Tucson, near Oracle and River, and I've got all kinds of bobcats and javelinas and coyotes and great horned owls. I think they're great horned owl. I heard it. I think that's what it is. I couldn't see it. I could hear it. That's what I think it is. And so I'm paying attention. And hawks. And my poor little puppy dog is so terrified. He just goes around smelling and barking. Pardon?
You live in the district, although that is not legal required.
I live in the district.
And you have for how long? Oh.
And I have been there almost all of my adult life. Yeah. I came here in 19... 19- Huh?
You're not old.
Yeah, you know what? I have no problem saying that I'm going to be 60 this year.
No,
so,
no.
Yeah. Truly am. So when I tell you that I have experiences, believe me, I've got experiences. I'm a real woman. I've lived a real life. And, you know, I've fallen down. And it's not so much if you make a mistake. It's really not about if you fall down. You're going to fall down. That's life. It's how you get back up, if you get back up, and then what do you do? That's what's really important. So if I've learned anything in my almost 60 years, that's one of the most valuable things I've learned. Yes?
This one, do you speak Spanish?
Oh, solo un poco.
Great if you did.
I'm learning.
Yeah. And one thing about Gabby Evan-Bisbee, and it was so nice to see her around, in
yeah.
She was so approachable. You could walk right up to her and talk to her.
I know.
It was pretty wonderful.
Yeah. Well, I've been invited to come down for the farmers markets in Bisbee and in Sierra Vista too. All right. So I'm going to be I'm gearing up my field campaign right now. I'm looking for people and organizing and so I'm trying to make a plan. So that I'm not just making a trip to Douglas, I'm making a trip to Douglas that includes Bisbee and Sierra Vista and Benson and Tombstone and Cascabel and everywhere in between. I'm coming to see you.
How much damage does the A-10 do to your campaign?
Not at all.
I mean,
not at all.
And support her.
Right. She's a one-note samba. That's all she's got. Now, I honor her. I respect her for her service. I do. But what else you got? I am going to be fighting for our military bases every bit as hard as Gabby and Ron did. She's not doing anything differently than they did. She's not. And the fact that she can fly an A-10 doesn't make her a better leader.
Exactly.
And I want people to remember that. I respect her and honor her for her service, just like I do the young man that's with me today, James Kinsey. He's a veteran, an Army veteran. He was at Fort Huachuca here. And he is wonderful. And I appreciate my brother's retired Navy, my aunt, was, I think, a WAC, is that what they, a WAC? She was a nurse?
Wait.
Army. WAC, okay, yes, she was a WAC. There you go, yay! Thank you for your service.
What a mess.
Well, Victoria, you spoke about Cascabel.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We lost our fight against the Sanzia Alliance, but there is a consequence of that. There is some follow-up, and there's going to be some pushback.
Good.
And so I hope that you would stay
informed
to any kind of fundraiser that we may the, and that, this goes out to everyone.
Yes.
Because we want to go to the, to court if we have to, but that's going to cost us some money.
Right.
To reverse the
decision. Good.
Because there was a lot of conflict of interest between SunZia, BLM, and some of the other agencies.
Right. Right.
So please stay, you know, informed about what is happening to us.
Well, I will tell you that I got married last November, mm-hmm. and my husband is a hydrogeologist.
Right.
He has a PhD in geology, and he works, he loves the San Pedro, and he is trying to, and some of the county supervisors in Pima County, particularly Richard Elias, Supervisor Elias has really stressed the importance of me focusing on the San Pedro. And Mark said, I'm there with you, I'll help you. You know, so I'm being well educated on the subject, and that will continue. That will continue because he's passionate about the San Pedro, and the SunZia project. Yeah, that I watched and knew that, knowing the makeup of the commission, I'm not surprised that it went the way that it was.
We were very lucky to get two members to be on our side.
Right.
And one was, it was strictly a political decision against the Obama administration. The
right.
other one, as the chairman was very well informed. He was, he based his decision on facts, and he said no to somebody, and so
wow.
we're very grateful for that.
Good.
But
good.
Maybe we can reverse it.
I hope so. Yeah. I hope so. And yes, I will stay in touch and stay informed.
Okay.
And be involved.
Thank
so
you.
Let me know. Thanks, guys.